Good morning. It's Brian here at His Expert Dojo. You are on our podcast. This is where we interview wonderful startups that we have invested in because we massively believe in their company. The startup that we're going to be talking to today is Sharmin over at Instoried. Instoried is a phenomenal company that we were fortunate enough to be able to invest in out of India that is bringing emotions to communication within large organizations, something which the world sorely needs right now. Sharmin, welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you so much, Brian, and thank you so much to Expert Dojo. This is amazing.
It's been such an exciting journey. I really enjoy this because I get to talk to you like I kind of semi-know you, but we've gone through 14 weeks, very intensive time together.
Yes. I think it was incredible, you know. I mean, we so needed it because the stage that we are at right now, you know, somewhere in between early and growth, I think the one push that you've given us to, you know, scale in the US has been phenomenal. And we are really looking forward to nail it, you know, where it should be in the US.
I don't know. You know, when I introduce you to people, I say you are one of, if not the best money raiser I've ever met. And there are two arguments in this place, in this world about how a company becomes a unicorn. And at some stage, those two arguments converge into one road, right? And one argument is, if you're the greatest money raiser in the world, you are going to raise enough money to be a unicorn. And the other argument is, well, if you can get phenomenal traction, then you're going to get to a place where people are going to want to give you money. And what's wonderful about what you've done is not only are you incredible at raising money, you've already raised millions of dollars, which we're going to talk about in a couple of minutes, but you're also phenomenal attraction because you've taken your company and built it from nothing, from just an idea when you were sitting in front of a computer, to now a real organization with a phenomenal team in place where you've got tens of thousands of dollars. I think you're up to $70,000 right now, monthly recurring revenue, and you've only just begun. Can you share with us a little bit about the story and about how you took yourself to this place?
Right. So, you know, I have to go back a little to sort of help you put things into perspective, right? So I lived in the US for about 7 years, you know, after I did my engineering. I was working with a number of Fortune giants there, like Microsoft, Walmart, and Pfizer, you know, the whole usual corporate shebang. But then after 7 years and over $100 million in recurring revenue, I realized that I was just helping the rich get richer. Wasn't adding too much value to my own life. And that's when the whole thing came to me that, hey, you know what? I have to do something of my own. So I came back to India, started my first company in the media space, ran that for about 3.5 years, and then sold that to a big production house here in India, took the money, exited. And then there was essentially no stopping. I knew that the only thing that I can do in this world is to build startups and then, you know, create more jobs, create an impact, and then scale.
And let me stop you there. Let me unpack that for a second, because it's highly unusual that a person will start up their first company and be able to get an exit, to reach a liquidity event where someone is prepared to give you money on the first go. What do you accredit that to? Was it all of the experience you had in the US? Was it what you had learned in your previous jobs? Or do you think this was something? I actually spoke to an investor about you yesterday and I had a wonderful call. And she said to me at the beginning, she said, I love Sharmin. I love her. I love what she's doing. I love the company. But most importantly, I love her. And I said to her, for a fact, a 100% fact, she is going to be ringing the bell on the stock exchange. Now, we never know which company it's going to be, right? Because we can have good luck or bad luck as investors. But for a fact, when I see a person with that in their eyes, you have it. And so I would actually almost answer the question myself, just saying I've never seen such a burning desire for someone to actually IPO a company, not get acquired or any of that stuff in the future, but to IPO.
Right. So, you know, yes, you are absolutely right. I am unstoppable. I am in that whole beast raising, you know, I mean, a fundraising beast mode. And also a lot of it because as a woman, first of all, you know, I hate to say this, but then we have to, you know, bear a lot in our lives. So one thing that was always there in me, and thanks to my parents who are also extremely careeristic, very adventurous, I always knew that if there was anything that I could do, it had to be build, grow, scale, create impact, and then build something else. You know, that is me. And a part of it is obviously because I'm from India. You know, we are very, very aspirational people, the so-called yet developing country. So, of course, we are very aspirational here to, you know, ensure that we do leave an indelible mark upon, you know, upon this world. So all of this, yes. So I think this is something that I've pretty much grown up with. First of all, a woman. Secondly, an Indian, and out there and unstoppable. So all of it together is, you know, essentially what has made me into what I am today. Yeah.
And the woman part, actually, you can see from the accelerator. We have, if we take solo female founders, I think we have 5 of the 13 countries or 6. And if you take like co-female founders, which, you know, is even more wonderful. We have a majority of women founders. And people say to me, like, why do you have a majority of female founders? And it's because of this, because of what you've just said. You know, that what you a rock gets forged over time. And yes, you have been made into an incredible mountain, and you're now unstoppable. So I love how you are, and I love what you're building. And I also love the whole idea of how you came to Instoried and why that became so important. Can you share a little bit with everybody about the genesis of the story of Instoried and why it's so important?
Absolutely. So, you know, I have personally worked with a number of CXOs globally, you know, guys like, for example, Uber and, you know, Ola in India, and a number of other, you know, massive startups, like when Booking.com was in its very nascent stages, Airbnb here in India, you know. So I really knew how the entire content industry works. Content marketing, unfortunately, it is, you know, it is in such a terrible state right now. So as we know that, you know, most of the companies out there, they are really, really bad at communicating. They have a tough time building human connections and communicating with empathy. And sadly, they are all flying blind. So the challenge is that most of the content creation is very, very intuition driven. You know, the way we feel that we should create content instead of really having a very data driven approach. So that's where the whole idea came to me that, hey, whenever I'm using Craigslist, why is it that I encounter such terribly written content? What if there were a way in which a content writer or a marketer could create content which would be so much more human, much more filled with empathy, that you would never ever lose out on a customer again? That was the whole idea, that why not build a phenomenal tool using AI, using a very data-driven, scalable, repeatable approach, so that you know that all of these content marketers out there will have a beautiful solution, an assistant which would help them relay their emotions better in order to help them connect and resonate with their audiences. That's how it's doing.
Fantastic. So in many ways, when people are actually communicating as an organization, they're either too emotional, in other words, they just say things that they think, and that's just not very smart in general. The world wouldn't be in such a mess if actually we didn't work like that. And then, or the second thing is, they're way too logical, but they don't work with common sense. And there's a structure that can be created to make sure that the optimal content is distributed to the customer. And that's where you go to, I suppose. If Grammarly was on steroids and was something which was of absolute use, we would be able to say anything that was the right thing to say to the other party. And that's what you're allowing the world to see now.
Absolutely. Yes. You know, it is a very simple assistant. It's a tool which will help all of these guys, first of all, channelize their content in the right direction. And then secondly, using a data-driven approach, you are already able to gauge and predict what your content's performance and engagement is going to be like, even before you've actually published the content. And that is a huge power, huge autonomy in the hands of all the content marketers out there, that you know how your content is going to perform post-publishing, even before you've actually published it, that is while you're creating it. That's where we are focused.
Wonderful. And I want to know the how hards, right? The first how hard is, how hard was it to raise the money that you raised? Because it is really, I know India, and I know how many angel investors there are that give small amounts of money. And I know how difficult it is as an entrepreneur to raise the money that you need. And the types of money you raised is like raising 10 times that amount of money over here. So my first how hard is on the investment. And then my second how hard is on building the team, because I've met members of your team. You have built an incredible team around you. So to instill that type of trust in the team is incredibly difficult.
Right. So, you know, yes, it was a major, major challenge. Needless to say that, you know, we all need funds because, first of all, we are an AI-driven company. All of the AI experts out there, machine learning, natural language processing guys, they are really, really expensive. So, first thing, what we did, I have put in $50,000 of my own money into this, you know, to essentially give it the first push. And then after that, we knew that, okay, we have to go out there and raise a round of funding. We reached out to anyone and everyone. First of all, we did not leave on even a single angel network in India, in Southeast Asia. Number of accelerator programs. We got a lot of free money from Startup Chile because they love the team. All of the fundraising happened at a stage where even the product wasn't ready. So we raised $2 million on just nothing but the team. You know, they all of my investors told me that, you know what, I'm just betting on you because I think you can sell. And that is the only thing. And, you know, of course, the whole idea, the concept, but execution was not even at a, you know, I mean, we had not even reached the most nascent stages, not even an alpha ready when we went and pitched. But I think the story was amazing. The team was incredible. The experience and the complementary skill sets that we carried, all of it summed up together, helped us raise $2 million. And I will tell you, I have not left out on a single investor in you know, Southeast Asia, Singapore, India, you know, United Arab Emirates, Dubai, all of that, nothing. We have investors, you know, from the US who do not invest in companies at my stage, but just because they loved what we were doing. So we got the money from these guys. And I think the only thing that actually led us to get this was that I did not leave out on anybody. I personally wrote to about 500 odd people on LinkedIn. You know, I was constantly following up with them. Then tried to reach out to all the possible VCs, all the angel networks, because I knew that, hey, you know what? Winter's coming. Let's get all the money that we can. So.
I love it. Listen, anybody who brings a Jon Snow comment into a podcast is a legend in my name. But I love, there's a few things you said there, which for entrepreneurs listening, I know most people listening to this are other investors, but for entrepreneurs listening, it's so important. You need to go after your network properly. You need to go beyond your network. You need to follow up. So many people don't follow up. I personally think you're being very humble and you have a certain amount of magic beyond that, though, because lots of people outreach, lots of people go beyond their network, and lots of people do actually follow up. But you need a certain something, a certain je ne sais quoi, where somebody looks at you and they think to themselves exactly what the investor said to me yesterday. I feel this lady's going to make it. I feel she's going to break through, and I don't want to miss out if she does. And to be able to do that.
Can I say something here? Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, I'm interrupting. But yeah. You know, you are bang on, right? I think you know me better than, you know, even what my co-founder does. And, you know, the only reason why I have this crazy amount of drive, of course, we are very, you know, extremely aspirational. But as a kid, I almost got killed twice. You know, I have seen death at you know, wow. I mean, at the most difficult junctures of my life, you know, I mean, at a genocide, you know, during a natural disaster, but then managed to escape and live, you know, live past those two incidents. So when life gives you a second chance, you take it. But when it gives you a third, you might as well do very well justice to it, you know. And that is what is the driving force, that I have to do this. There is no other option.
I love that. I actually think there's really something there. And if we look around us, and I mean everybody who's listening to this podcast, if you look around you, most of the people are just making their way through life. You know, it's Monday, so I got to get through Monday to get to the weekend. I'm going to watch a Netflix movie and then going to maybe get to Tuesday and Wednesday the following week. And then you get to the end and they say, okay, I made it. And then there's a few people and they have this spark, and you know that this spark is going to create something incredible, or it's not, but they are going to do every single thing, every ounce of energy they have to make sure that no stone is left unturned. And I think that's why investors love you, because they know you're all in. There's no, I might wake up late this morning because, hey, you know what? Maybe I'll go for a walk and I'll relax a little bit. It's impossible for you. You are so driven to making a positive impact in this world, which will, by the way, financially benefit the investors who back you on that positive impact. And that's what investors see. So incredible. And then, so did you work the same magic with your team? I'm guessing the answer is a very simple yes, because to attract really strong people around you in a team in the early stage is near impossible. It's not that you don't, even being nice isn't enough, because these people, if they're that strong, which your team are that strong, then they have so many offers where they can get IPOs within the next few years, stock options, great salaries and everything else. And you are offering nothing except the future.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes, you are correct. I have a phenomenal team. You know, my co-founder is, he is just the best when it comes to owning the entire technology, you know, pretty much single-handedly. He's ensured that under his tutelage, the entire tech team has performed to such crazy levels. I mean, we have always, you know, ended up meeting deadlines before, you know, it was actually a deadline. And the team has performed amazingly well. So I must say that my co-founder, Raj, he is just incredible. And another thing, one thing that we are always very, very sure of is that a skill, you know, as in be it something about coding, be it about selling, be it about marketing, a skill is something that you can acquire on the job. But for me, the only thing that matters is the right attitude. So whenever we are interviewing people, we ensure that they are startup material. They are, you know, hustlers who can essentially chase and close down a thing, be it in sales, be it in tech. And, you know, 100% of our, you know, current success is a total function of the attitude of the team and not the aptitude. So that is what we do. Yes.
And how many people do you have in the team now?
25.
You're a beast. You're an absolute beast.
Five more are joining.
Five more are joining. Incredible. And those people, and I can only imagine you in the office with those people. How has the pandemic affected you and affected like the work life of your team in the office? And are they working from home? And how do you continue to drive them every single day?
So first of all, you know, it's an extremely diverse team. So we are all working from home. There is one working from Estonia. There is one working from Finland. And then the remaining of the team right now, yes, it is working from different parts of India. You know, so we didn't really want to limit anybody, you know, with respect to travel and, you know, all the restrictions that were there during COVID-19, because of course it's a virtual product. So we are all working from home. And but then one thing that we ensure is that there is no communication gap. So we have daily calls at, you know, 10 a.m. And the leadership team, that is four of us. So, you know, me, the CTO, the head of marketing and the head of partnerships, the four of us every Saturday, you know, this is a rule which is mandated by me, that every Saturday, 10 a.m. to 12 p.m., leave everything that you're doing, even if it is just to wish each other good morning. And if there is nothing to discuss, still, you got to make it at 10 a.m. on the call every Saturday, the four of us. And we discuss whatever it is, you know, strategy for the future. Or if it is just nothing, then just hello, good morning, what are you doing? Simple, but we have to meet up. This is, you know, I am not trying to build a church. I'm trying to build a religion. So I need to ensure that everyone is there, engaged and focused as much as I am. So yes, we do that.
You know, I'm going to steal that, right? I'm not trying to build a church. I'm trying to build a religion. I am going to unceremoniously steal
Please
that.
Please do. I'm so happy.
And I love the obsessive focus on success, because what that would be looked at by weak people as too much. They would say, wow, on a Saturday morning, well, why would you do that? Like, it's really tough. People might be there with their families, or people might be have things to do. What strong people, what people who understand this business know, is that speed is our enemy.
Absolutely.
And that the worst thing you can do is allow everybody to just truck along, to build the business nicely, to say, come in when you want, Friday is beach days, make sure you relax and have a good time because a happy worker is a strong worker. No, we die because speed is not the priority. And what I love about you is everything from how you speak to your focus on the team to the way that you drive everybody is all about the same principle. Guys and gals, the quicker we IPO, the quicker everybody here is in the most phenomenal cash position you've ever been in your life. And more importantly, the quicker we have made our mark on the planet. And we can either take 20 years to get it or we can get there next Tuesday. What do you want to do? And it's a beautiful way of seeing how many people are actually as committed to that cause as you are.
Absolutely. You are correct. So for me, like you said, you know, so there are two animals which are always there in my head. One is a horse, one is a cheetah. You know, I am the latter. I am the cheetah. I am the fastest woman out there who is here to just rob everyone in a positive way, you know, get their money. Because for me, winter is always coming, although in Bangalore, there's no winter practically. But, you know, winter is always coming and a little extra money is always great, you know. So I am now looking at raising my next round and then a large Series A and then scale globally, you know. There is no stopping. You've got to be the cheetah, the fastest animal on this planet. I am not going to take 20 years to go IPO. No, I have a 5-year plan and I'm extremely focused and nothing can, you know, take me away from that. So
incredible.
5 years, bang on, short-term goals, let's go achieve it.
I love that. And there's something that's very important for investors to take from this as well. Plenty of people in startup work on weekends, right? It's not an anomaly, right? Almost everybody does it. But what I love about what you've said is not, oh, we're going to work on Saturdays and we're going to work on Sundays and we're going to see who's going to code the latest or who's going to work the longest. What you say is we are going to take a strategy gap. We are going to take a vision gap. And that vision gap is our moments to see, are we on track? And there's no fixed agenda that we have to follow, BS, because they are things that we had as activities to do for the week. This is not even really about OKRs or anything like that. This is about, is our vision online? And by the way, it always has to be adapted. It always has to be pivoted. It always has to be amended. So allowing for that 2 hours allows you that time where you can sit back from 30,000 feet and say, what do we need to have for next week? For next week to be the best week we've ever had.
Absolutely. And that's exactly what we do, you know. So we have a very clear segmentation done. I am going to talk about nothing but fundraising. You know, the head of marketing is going to talk about nothing but marketing. The partnerships person is going to tell all about her partnerships and collaborations that she has in the future in the pipeline or what is running. And of course, my tech co-founder is going to talk about what are the things that need to be done, you know, how we can make it better, how do we increase productivity, efficiency, and of course, on top of everything, you know, where are we heading? What is it that, you know, we can do differently? Where did we go wrong? Get all the constructive feedback in place and ensure that we are executing it in the correct way, because no idea is awesome, right? It's all about the execution. So we need to get it correct.
Absolutely. And I want to look at the hero's journey a little bit here. And I want to look at kind of, everybody can see how you're coming to this incredible place of success, but it can't have always been this easy. There have to have been challenges at the beginning. Can you maybe share a little, maybe just a little bit about some of the resilience challenges that you had as you were launching this, as you were getting it off the ground? And look, this could be as banal as it was really hard to do the tech, because it was really hard to do the tech, or it could be something as important as I had a co-founder or I had mentors or I had advisors and they were not particularly helpful because of X. We don't need to name people, but I think the messages and the stories tell 1,000 words, right?
Yes, all of this has happened to me, all of it. So, you know, number one, I have put in about $50,000 of my own money into this. You know, we were initially bootstrapped for the first few months. And then there came a time when we didn't even have money to, you know, pay out our employees or for that matter, even pay for the co-working space. We were working out of a WeWork here in Bangalore and we couldn't even, you know, we didn't have even $100 to pay for like a one day seat. It was that bad. So then, you know, we did whatever that we had to, you know, to essentially stay afloat. My co-founder borrowed money from his wife to fund my trip to London because I was going to meet an HNI there who was supposed to fund us $500,000. I didn't have money to pay for my visa application, you know. So he took $1,000 from his wife and gave it to me. He's like, listen, I'm going to do this. Go get the bloody money. I was like, okay, I'm going to get it. So he did that, number one. Number two, you know, I borrowed money, of course, from, you know, friends and, you know, wherever that we could. I even had a few bonds in place, you know, as in some of the investments that I'd made here in India. You know, I even sold my jewelry to, you know, get some money to essentially keep us afloat for the next 4 months. And yes, and then, you know, after that, we want to ensure that we have as much runway as possible before we are able to close even like $1 million. So we did all of this. And of course, a very, very major challenge from a tech perspective is that everything that we've built is, you know, completely done in-house. It's absolutely proprietary. We had to ensure that we were getting the right talent. We were interviewing 300 people and out of that, just getting 3 to 5 people on board. You know, I mean, that was the ratio of, you know, the opportunity to wins for us with respect to hiring. That was essentially very difficult. And I've never said this, this another point, but since you asked, I will say it. Raj is actually the second co-founder. You know, initially I had another CTO who cheated me and ran away with the code and then blocked me, you know. So as a result of that, the entire activity got delayed by 6 months. But then after Raj, who's our current CTO, joined, then we had to start from zero again. And then, you know, we sort of decided to scale up and see how we can do things. So all of these things have happened, you know, but then now, thankfully, we have, you know, we are more than just afloat. We are doing really well. But yes, we have seen all of it. We've seen a very dark abyss that we never thought we would fall into, but we fell there and then we came out and now we are doing good.
I'm going to move my analogy from, you know, the tiniest stone into the greatest mountain. And I'm going to say that the hottest fire forges the best steel, right? The best sword. Absolutely. I'm going to take something out of Conan the Barbarian here, because there are so many people who encounter what you went through, but they don't break through. Now, there are so many CTOs that take code. There are so many investors that don't come through. There's so many people who borrow off their wife. That's pretty brave. are selling your jewelry. Even I was starting to shed a tear at that. But it's forged a stronger steel, right? Yeah. Now you're unbreakable. And as a team, you've gone through so much.
And you know, another point is that I never had a plan B. You know, I didn't know what else to do. For me, it was just this. I was like, I am going to do whatever it takes to just make this thing work, because there absolutely was no other option for me. I knew that I cannot do anything else but sell, but be a founder, run a company, grow, get jobs, and, you know, create an impact. That is the only thing I can do. So I was like, we have to do this. And, you know, There was no looking back.
I love it. So let's look at the going forward now. You've built this incredible company. You've got pretty much 30 staff working for you. You've raised $2 million in some of the hardest regions to raise money on the planet, the equivalent in my book to $20 or $30 million being raised in the United States. You're launching over in the US. You've got $70,000 in monthly recurring revenue. You have some huge partnerships coming on with large dating folks, with huge organizations and other things. Talk to me about that journey and what it looks like over the next 3 to 5 years so that investors can see where you're going.
Absolutely. So first thing, you know, we were initially only B2B. right? So we were just selling to SMEs and, you know, all of the marketing agencies, primarily India and, you know, Southeast Asia focused, because we are in India right now. And then we realized that, you know, we need to make some of those amazing partnerships, collaborations with some of the largest companies out there who can essentially either get us the leads or help us, you know, scale our product by including our APIs into their product. So turns out we got 3 acquisition offers, you know, at a point when I was just trying to collaborate with them. And that's, although we said no, but then we were like, hey guys, you know what, let's collaborate, because there's a direct portfolio fit. That essentially took us to a level wherein right now, you know, at per second, with the least traffic possible, right now our servers are experiencing 1,000 API calls per second, which is essentially the least engagement that I'm talking about. You know, that is at midnight when most people are sleeping, but we still get 1,000 API calls per second. During peak hours, that number is like 50x, you know. Wow. And then through these collaborations and through these partnerships, we are right now closing a partnership with one of the largest dating platforms globally, which would essentially take us to over 30 million plus mobile devices, you know, and then that would be a huge, huge breakthrough for us. Second thing, we are about to close a partnership with one of the largest content companies globally, which would take us to over 50,000 plus, you know, SMEs, direct entry into that market. Massive it is going to be. So all of these things, we have the tech in place, we have the sales guys in place. As we speak, my head of marketing is interviewing a few people in the US. We're going to be in LA. We're going to close down all of the marketing agencies. And I'm going to sit in your office in Expert Dojo and work.
You got it. My office is your office. LA is your town. And yes. I love this. And for even for angels or investors trying to unpack this, multiple acquisition offers, large partnerships at such an early stage, and such huge plans. And then the next raise is going to be when?
So we are already raising. So we are raising another $2 million as part of a late seed, you know, after the last $2 million. So we thought, mm-hmm. let's do another two. Out of which, one third of the round has already been subscribed. Mm-hmm. And we have
soft commitments
for a little more. And yes, we're going to use this money to essentially scale in the US. We are looking at a Delaware C Corp corporation sometime next week. And then, yes, we are unstoppable.
Fantastic. And then I'm guessing that we're probably going to get to the end of 2021 and you'll be going for a very large Series A.
Yes. So post this $2 million, we are looking at a $15 million in Series A that we will be in the US. And as a C Corp entity then that we want to target. And then I'll be in LA.
And my guess is at that stage, the monthly recurring revenue will jump to a few $100,000 a month. I'm guessing somewhere between $200,000 and $400,000.
Absolutely. So we have a very, very clear roadmap in place. Right now, we are at a $70,000 in MRR. By the end of this financial year, we should clearly be reaching to at least a $250,000 plus in monthly recurring revenue with all the partnerships, with all the sales guys, with all the marketing agencies on board. I cannot overemphasize the fact that, yes, we are well ahead of our
projections. So I just want to say, investors out there, I want to say two things. Number one, we've invested in her, so I'm so happy. That was the best $50,000 we ever put to work in our lives. So there are sometimes we make investments and we think, ooh, maybe that wasn't the greatest idea in the world. And then there are other times we make investments and we go home like the cat that's just, I just had the cheese or just had the milk. So for me, right now, when I'm here and I'm sitting here and I'm talking to Sharmin and I know where she's going in the future and I've seen her in action as she's come through the accelerator program, I have never been more optimistic about an entrepreneur, about what he or she is going to achieve. And I think Instoried are going to do phenomenal things. Number two, I think as anybody's listening to this podcast, the one thing that you can see and hear is incredible focus and energy. I don't even like doing the podcast because normally I have the max energy and I look low energy here with Sharmin. So it's kind of annoying me. But she's the most focused and energy-driven person you'll ever know. And that is required in early-stage startup. So I'd like you to finish with two things. Number one, I'd like you to share just a statement which represents your journey in entrepreneurship. Tell people, like, when you think about entrepreneurship, you think about Instoried, you think about what's got you here and where you're going in the future and how it defines you, or maybe what other people can learn from that that you can share with them. And just while you're thinking about that, then also share with everybody your email address and your website URL so people can get in contact with you. And of course, everybody here knows that you can always contact me, Brian, at Expert Dojo. I am an investor in Sharmin. I'm an investor in Instoried. I will very happily jump on a call with anybody and talk about this wonderful founder who's here on the podcast with me. So share with us final words to inspire.
So there is just one thing that I personally believe the most in, because so many people out there told me that, hey, you know what? What are you doing? Why are you wasting your time? Stop doing this. Nobody's going to fund you. Nobody's going to, you know, like you, XYZ. I was like, silence is so golden sometimes, because what should speak is your work. Show, don't tell, you know, as they say. So I was like, I'm going to make it. My work is going to speak for itself. The only thing that I have always believed in is, no matter what those people say, 100% of your success is a direct function of your attitude and not your aptitude, you know.
Oh,
you
come on.
An Ivy League degree to, you know, go out there, do what you have to. You can, if you are driven and if you have the right attitude. That's the only thing that I have. I'm here to constantly learn, grow, scale, get exciting people on board, help them grow. You know, it's not just about me. It's a mutual win-win. It's about growing together. That is what a company is about. So just have the right attitude and you are going to nail it. Never, never stop, you know. And another thing about me is that I am unapologetic in my attitude. I am brutal. I'm out there to tell people what I think is right. I'm not here to please everyone. One life, I get to please myself first. And the only thing that can help me in pleasing myself is when I'm creating the right impact. And I think I'm doing that. So that's
wonderful. That's I love that. That is strong. It's very strong. And then when you're sharing, please, about Instoried, I'd like if you can spend a moment and just talk a little bit about how it can impact also the companies of the investors that are listening as well. Because I don't just want investors to listen to this and say, oh, Brian is quite smart. He's invested in this great founder and this great company. I want to speak to her. I also want them to think, should my companies be using Instoried as a tool for them to be more successful? So share with them your email, share with them the web address, but also share with everybody why Instoried today, not in the future, today is a vital tool for their startup, for their founders.
Right. So, you know, when you talk about content, right, it's everywhere. Be it your blogs, be it your emails, be it your social media, Insta, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, anywhere and everywhere, content is everywhere, you know. So if you do not have marketing content, no problem. I'm sure you still write emails. So for all of your internal communication, this is an amazing tool which would essentially help you gauge what is the tone of your content, what is the empathy quotient of your content, and help you relay your thoughts better. A beautiful content assistant driven by, of course, a tech, you know, very, very strong tech, which is there in the background, completely proprietary, very easy to use. Plug and play DIY device, end to end, all of your content requirements, starting from your emails to SMSs to all of your social, digital, ad content, anything and everything Instoried is there. All you have to do is log on to Instoried.com, or you could just go to app.instoried.com and start using the tool. And if you'd like to reach me, I'm Sharmin and I'd love to connect with you guys. I'm reachable at Sharmin, S-H-A-R-M-I-N at instoried.com, or you could just look me up and I'm there everywhere on there on Google.
I will say, in summary, you are the ultimate startup beast and there is no higher compliment.
Thank you.
That's a wrap. You are awesome.
Thank you, Brian. You two are amazing. And that's why we're going to build a bloody unicorn.
Now, we are going to build a bloody unicorn.
Yes. Thank you so much for doing this, Brian. Love you. Thank you.
Oh, you too.